45 seconds
to the trail, 45. I'm sorry, that doesn't make any sense at all.
This is Jeff Moore, and Jeff Mead, live Eastern Saudi Arabia.
Sometimes you can't fight fate.
It always happens at the worst time.
It shouldn't happen to newsreaders. Tonight at 10 on ITV.
Now in Carlton, an election result update with Jonathan Dimbleby.
Good afternoon and welcome back to ITV Election 2001. Tony Blair has said that his historic election victory was an instruction to deliver from the country. He's back at Downing Street beginning his second term and now working on the cabinet reshuffle, which is expected later this afternoon. For the Conservatives, it's change, of course, at the very top. They are now facing a leadership contest after William Hague declared that he intends to stand down. Michael Portillo is the bookmaker's favourite to succeed him, but there are other names in the ring as well. Michael Heseltine has said that Kenneth Clarke is the only Conservative who could win a general election. Sue Saville reports.
Kissing babies is a long political tradition. Tony Blair brought out his one-year-old son Leo to join the family in acknowledging what he called Labour's remarkable and historic victory.
It is a mandate for reform and for investment in the future, and it is also very clearly an instruction to deliver. I've learnt many things over the past 4 years as Prime Minister. I've learned, I hope, from the mistakes as well as the good things. But above all else, I've learned of the importance of establishing the clear priorities of government, of setting them out clearly for people, and then focusing on them relentlessly, whatever events may come and go. I believe in the last 4 years, we have laid foundations. I believe our victory in this election shows that the British people understand we have laid foundations. But now is the time to build upon them. Thank you.
It had been a long morning, arriving by plane into London at dawn, greeting supporters at Labour Party headquarters, before heading to Buckingham Palace for a courtesy private audience with the Queen. But the political bombshell of the morning was William Hague's resignation as leader of the Conservative Party.
I believe it's vital that the party be given the chance to choose a leader who can build on my work, but also take new initiatives and hopefully command a larger personal following in the country. And I've therefore decided to step down as leader of the Conservative Party when a successor can be elected in the coming months. I wish I could have led you to victory, but now we must all work for our victories of the future. Thank you very much indeed.
No potential contender has yet thrown their hat in the ring, but names are already being put forward.
The most popular, in the sense of broad appeal, outside the activists of the party, is Ken Clarke. Within the activists of the Tory party, the most popular person is Michael Portillo. But that doesn't take you, the activists, to the winning ground. And the issue is whether we can find a way of devising policies which will appeal to the middle ground without which you never win.
But Kenneth Clarke himself won't yet be drawn on whether he'll stand for the leadership.
First of all, I spend the weekend resting and reflecting on the defeat and trying to think, you know, what is best next for a Conservative Party after this sad defeat.
The position of the Liberal Democrats leader, Charles Kennedy, was definitely not in question this morning.
It has been a really fantastic campaign to lead, and I think it has been a fantastic victory. But I think it's a victory that puts down a marker that we are the party of the future, and that this decade can see us as part of the governance of our country. Thank you very much indeed.
Even before the euphoria has died down, Tony Blair says it's straight back to business. A cabinet reshuffle is due to be announced shortly for this first ever second term for a Labour government. Sue Saville, ITV Election 2001.
That's one of the photographs that will be in the family album. It could have been tempting, John, to use that sort of scene rather earlier in the campaign.
It's, of course, very significant and interesting that he did not do that, but he's almost demonstrating, isn't he, to the press and to the media this is the photo opportunity I could have used in the campaign, but I didn't. So he's using it the day after and showing what a fantastic photo that is of his family, and obviously the strength they have for each other and the pride that he feels in all his family, particularly his one-year-old baby.
Meanwhile, the wolves are circling, their handlers are speaking or not speaking as we look towards what could be a very bloody fight for the leadership of the Conservative Party.
A very tricky fight, and one of their main problems among many is what sort of leader do they want, and is this the leader that might take them into a Euro referendum campaign? They simply don't know, and that's what's adding to the confusion. Michael Heseltine there, talking gently about Michael Portillo might just be a choice for the activists, but would he suit the middle ground? He didn't mention Europe, but that's what it's all about. For Michael Heseltine, why should there be a Eurosceptic candidate? What about Ken Clark? But for so many of the activists, Europe will be a key issue, and they wouldn't dream of supporting the candidature of Ken Clark.
Well, there we are. We'll pursue that again, I'm quite certain. Meanwhile, Dermot can tell us a little bit more with his virtual reality graphics about turnout and the Commons. Dermot Murnaghan.
Well, Jonathan, one of the more worrying features for politicians and everyone interested in the democratic process is the huge fall in turnout. Let's have a look at how it's declined over the decades. Starting back in 1950 then, a massive turnout, certainly by today's standards, 83.9% involved in that election. 1979, 29 years later, Mrs. Thatcher's first victory, of course, there, 76%, three-quarters of the electorate. 1997, Mr. Blair's first victory, 71%. And look at it now, in just 4 years, a massive decline. Here we are below 60%, down to 59.2, which means that one in four only of the electorate voted for Tony Blair and the Labour Party. Nevertheless, that hasn't affected the fact that they've got another huge majority. So let's move in to the House of Commons now and remind ourselves of how many MPs each party will have. Remember, 659 seats up for grabs at this election. Let's now allocate them to their parties. This is the government side of the House. Four more years, maybe five more years on these benches for these 413 Labour MPs. What about the Conservatives? Still, of course, under the leadership of Mr. Hague until they replace him. And what a coincidence, exactly the same number of MPs they had after the 1997 election, 165. Now, the Liberal Democrats had the best performance in terms of percentage gains over the evening. They will have 53 MPs. And the other parties, the Nationalists from Scotland, Plaid Cymru, there's parties in Northern Ireland, and one independent, 28 MPs there. What about the majority? Let's remind ourselves of the size of this second historic landslide, 167-seat majority for Tony Blair. Jonathan.
Thanks, Dermot, very much. And there's now a very tiny modification to that, because in the Isle of Wight, which is a Liberal Democrat seat, won in 1997, it has now gone to the Conservatives. So the Conservatives have increased their number of seats to 166. The Liberal Democrats have gone down to 52. I think we can see the results now. Yes, here we are, the Conservatives with 25,223 votes. Liberal Democrats in second place, 22,397. Labour way behind. There was a swing from Liberal Democrats to Conservative of 6.6%. That was a very large swing. So the Isle of Wight has gone one way and another, but at the moment it is Conservative again. And now for an election update to the latest news, Mary Nightingale.
Thanks, Jonathan. Well, of course, all eyes are on Downing Street this afternoon as Tony Blair finalises his new cabinet. Hotly tipped to emerge as the new Home Secretary is David Blunkett. His job as education could go to Estelle Morris, who held on to her marginal Birmingham Yardley seat. John Prescott is set to stay as Deputy Prime Minister, but may no longer have a department of his own to run. Fuel protesters have pledged to carry on with their campaign despite Labour's overwhelming victory. One of their leaders, David Handley, has claimed the government isn't representative of the British people, and he said Tony Blair should know they have lots of plans over the next 12 months. Well, the Conservative Party's fallen a long way since she was in power, but this afternoon Lady Thatcher gave a defiant response to her party's second annihilation at the polls.
Obviously, this is a very disappointing result. William Hague worked tirelessly from start to finish, and so it's a particularly sad moment for him, and also for Fionn, and for the rest of us. But, my friends, Make no mistake, the Conservative Party will be back.
The Scottish Tory chairman has followed his party leader's example and resigned. Raymond Robertson quit after the Scottish Tories failed to capture their key targets. The Scottish Nationalist Party leader, John Swinney, is also under pressure after his party failed to make gains.
The election has established the SNP as the second party in Scottish politics. I'm obviously disappointed we didn't manage to hold on to the Galloway constituency, which we lost by a whisker. But it's quite clear that the SNP are the principal challengers to the Labour Party in Scotland.
Oldham's Labour MP, Michael Meacher, has called for an independent inquiry to discover why so many people there voted for the British National Party. The NP candidates were greeted by crowds of anti-Nazi protesters as they went to the count. The party won more than 11,000 votes in the town, which recently witnessed the worst race riots in 15 years. And finally, if William Hague feels like drowning his sorrows this afternoon, he could do worse than visit the Angel Pub in his hometown of Rotherham. The landlord is offering him 14 free pints, the amount Mr. Hague said he used to drink a day while delivering beer in the area. Well, that's the latest election news. Now back to you, Jonathan.
Thanks. An intriguing little footnote to this election. Dr. Richard Taylor, who won in Wyre Forest as the independent candidate, the doctor fighting to save the hospital, is going to meet up with Martin Bell, who was in the last parliament the only independent. They're meeting up. They actually went to the same school together. Joe Andrews is in Downing Street. Joe, what have you got? Where are we with the reshuffle?
Well, we think the reshuffle is going on behind us. We don't know any details of it yet. What we've been told is that we won't know until it's absolutely complete. In years past, what we've found is that names have dribbled out. We've learnt this, we've learnt that. They're saying that's not going to happen this time. We'll wait till it's complete. We'll tell you when it is, and we expect to hear that sometime this afternoon or even early this evening. We've got the first demonstration of this administration down beyond the gates of Downing Street. You might be able to hear some of them shouting. We are expecting to see some of the new cabinet ministers or some of the people who are going to be moved into prime positions come through those gates down there in the next hour or so. We think that the Prime Minister will want to be seen with some of them. People like Estelle Morris, who's heavily tipped to be the next Education Secretary, and probably David Blunkett, tipped to move into Jack Straw's job at the Home Office. Jonathan.
Joe, thanks very much. We're going to take a short break now, but stay with us for the latest developments and how in Wyre Forest, Labour was beaten on the health service. That's after the break.
At Asda, our low prices just keep getting lower and lower. And because we're always rolling back prices throughout the store, it means whenever you shop, you'll always get low prices. That's Asda price.
Does this dress make me look fat?
No, your fat makes you look fat.
Beware, the real coffee taste of Kenko Rapport may bring out the real you.
7 years of the measurements of the house. Brings it forward to the receptivity of a
girl.
Simply dive the blinds cross over his eyes. You follow?
No, no.
Who are you?
I'm a mum, and I know the difference between Ribena Tooth Kind and these drinks with no added sugar. This shows how much teeth are eroded by the drinks tested, clearly showing that Ribena Tooth Kind is almost as kind to teeth as water.
There's only one tooth kind, Ribena Tooth Kind.
If your life revolves around your kitchen, take a look around Mobin. At Mobin, your kitchen is designed around you and fully installed at no extra cost. Mobin's all-inclusive sale is now on, with every sale kitchen at half price, integrated appliances at half price, and a free dishwasher with every kitchen. For your nearest Mobin showroom, call 0800 413 413.
This stylish three-seater leather sofa is half price. One of the amazing savings in the Court Serious Summer Sale. Now on.
Excuse me, would you like to try a Campino?
Ooh, sweet.
Mmm, strawberries and cream.
They're not bad.
A bit like ice cream.
Yeah, really creamy.
Discover Campino. The real taste of strawberries and cream in a sweet.
It's hard to believe a sweet can taste this good.
Lurpak Spreadable is the perfect choice for busy lives. It spreads straight from the fridge, so you can have the smooth, delicate taste of Lurpak anytime you want. Missing something, Douglas? Lurpak Spreadable, perfect for busy lives. Thank you, Douglas.
New Crystal Air from Haze has an innovative glass design containing waves of real perfume which fragrance your home for over 4 weeks.
Haze, fragrances that change your world.
Now I can order my shopping fresh from Asda at Home. It's easier than ever to enjoy permanently low prices from Asda at Home.
Welcome back to ITV's Election 2001. One of the surprise results of the night was in Worcestershire, where a retired doctor swept to an extraordinary victory in a single-issue campaign. He was protesting about the downgrading of the Kidderminster Hospital. Dr. Richard Taylor said that the massive vote he received was a reaction of the people against a powerful political system that had overridden their will. Helen Wright reports.
Once this doctor does take his seat in the House, he will be a constant reminder to the government of voters' high expectations for the NHS. The single issue of the fate of Kidderminster Hospital, stripped of key services, won him astonishing support.
It's a protest vote against the political system, which allows a government with a huge majority to take no notice whatsoever of the people and to spin their decision.
Dr. Taylor secured almost three times as many votes as the sitting Labour MP, a landslide to this retired hospital consultant.
Richard Taylor, independent Kidderminster Hospital and Health Concern, 28,000.
And though he's been careful not to promise a complete restoration of hospital services, his constituents have high expectations today.
I think it's brilliant that he's been voted in, so hopefully our services at this hospital will come back.
He knows what the people want, and I think he will fight tooth and nail to get something done about this.
But even his supporters on the local paper recognise there are limits to what Dr. Taylor can achieve.
The big danger is that doors will be shut on him at Westminster because he's an independent and he's coming on a single-issue ticket.
This may have been a single-issue campaign on the services at this one hospital, but its success highlights Labour's continuing vulnerability on health. The voters here are certainly hoping for more for the NHS from Labour's second term than they got in its first. Helen Wright, ITV Election 2001.
What a really interesting result. And Helen Wright really touched on it there. You saw an opportunity in one place for a particular group of people to say no. I bet all over the country a lot of people were saying, what a terrific result.
Yes, a lot of people would have liked to have said that, but in many constituencies they couldn't. It's a bit reminiscent of Martin Bell in Tatton, isn't it? Choose one issue, in that case it was sleaze. It was a big issue at the election. And make your vote count. It's the end of ideology at one level, and also it's the sense in which people thought they knew the result before any other votes were counted.
Absolutely. Now on to Tony Blair. No other Labour leader, as we've been saying ever since we started virtually earlier this night, last night, has ever faced the prospect of a second full term in office, and Tony Blair has been a Prime Minister who was always intent on staying there. He said today that he sees this victory as an instruction from the voters to deliver. After all, delivery, or failing to deliver, was indeed the criticism he had to face during the campaign. So what's he going to do now with another 4 or perhaps 5 years in office? Here's John Ray.
New Labour, New Britain, the slogan holds good. But if the going first time round was slow, Second time round, supporters say Labour Dan disappoint.
It's essential that Tony Blair gets really brave this time. He tends to say himself, Mrs. Thatcher didn't invent Thatcherism till her second term. Wait and see. Well, we're waiting to see.
Even the greatest are eventually consigned to history, but this is Tony Blair's chance to make history. The first Labour Prime Minister to serve two successive full terms.
This is the biggest opportunity a radical government has had for the last 100 years. He can do almost what he likes.
Fresh-faced, he launched a first-term war on poverty on this London estate. Here, expectations are high.
I think they want to see more. I don't know if people think that Labour are on the right track. I do. I think
Camilla Sheldon leads a local initiative to rebuild the estate. There's millions in government money, but progress is slow. Like so much of New Britain, it's still in the planning stage.
I mean, if you interview me in 4 years' time and we're still scrabbling around not doing anything, I shall be very depressed.
No.
Labour promises world-class education. The local school, world-class, has another meaning.
We've recruited two English teachers from South Africa, applied for their work permits, etc., etc., just to have some English teachers, which, as I keep saying, is a national disgrace.
10,000 more teachers, Labour says, and many more specialist state schools, in science perhaps, or languages. And that, some believe, will mean selection.
You will say, when you think of where your little Johnny or Jenny goes to, I want her to go one of the better ones. And the better ones will be the specialist schools. If there are better ones, the worst ones. And the worst ones will deteriorate.
The NHS provides a bigger challenge still. The prescription, more doctors, more nurses, more private investment. This consultant says that's impossible to deliver in 4 years.
You can't suddenly, with a magic wand, create more of me. Such a thing will take at least a decade to make a difference to. And we need long-term stability. We need, really, the politics to be taken out.
Public services, it might be the last chance saloon for them. Unless Labour can prove that they can deliver, that they can spend a lot more money and produce a brilliant NHS and a brilliant education system, there's real danger that at the next election, the Tories will step in and say, doesn't work, we want to privatise it all.
But the biggest test of all, that's up to Tony Blair. Will he set a course for the single currency? Friends on the left say he must hold his nerve.
I think entry to the euro will be, in a sense, the big historic issue of the second term. It's the moment at which Britain will choose whether we are a real European country, whether we identify with Europe, or whether we wish to remain an offshore island.
If he wants to be a statesman who put Britain's interests first, he's got to take Britain into euro, and I think he will.
A second term secured, and for Tony Blair, the toughest decisions are still to come. But knowing when to confront, when to court public opinion, is the mark of true leadership.
The challenge of a second landslide. And with me now, Tony Benn, who's on the sidelines this election for the first time in something like 50 years, not fighting it directly. Tony, how do you read this second landslide? A, a very low turnout. B, a massive victory.
Well, I went round 25 constituencies throughout the country. But what I think is the progressive Americanization of British politics. The election campaign from the party headquarters were negative, personalized, abusive, cheap, and yet the issues are very interesting and challenging and interest young people. We now have this extraordinary phenomenon of a Labour landslide where 3 out of 4 of the people in this country didn't actually vote for it. And I think that the whole political landscape would alter. We have a very right-wing Labour government. I've worked to get it elected. But I think when the issues come up about the privatisation of health and education, about Star Wars, about the environment, you will find a loose coalition of people working to reverse the policy on which the government was elected.
But it's difficult to see, isn't it, the Labour Party moving back into the territory that you would like to see
it occupy? It's forward. No, it's not back.
You saw what happened when Hartlepool, where you had the archetypal New Labour Peter Mandelson against Arthur Scargill.
And the safe seat aside, that's not the point. The point is, for the first time... No, it isn't. Arthur Scargill made a mistake to leave the Labour Party and stand us on. But for the first time in my life, the public is to the left of the Labour Party. There's not a single Labour leader advocating the public ownership of the railways, and 80% of the population want it. The pendulum is swinging back now, and apathy works both ways. If students think the government's apathetic by imposing tuition fees, they respond. We've got to re-engage the energy of young people involved in all the protests back into the political
now,
process.
You never lose your enthusiasm, you never lose your passion, well, of course, but I would put it to you that the reality of this is that New Labour is occupying ground where it can win in those marginal seats that make the difference between forming a government and having a good idea.
Well, take a moving picture. Don't take a thing. In Chesterfield, which is a Labour town, we lost 8,000 votes because the people of Chesterfield are Labour and are not attracted by Rupert Murdoch.
But they voted Liberal Democrat this time.
No, I'm saying the point is I had 8,000 more votes because it was a Labour town. But it wasn't a new Labour town. Wait and see. There are those 75% haven't yet made up their mind. I think that British politics will move to the left.
Tony Benn, it's been really nice having you with us. Thanks for coming in. And now we can go to Scotland to find out what's been happening there and Scottish Television's political editor, Bernard Ponsonby. Bernard.
Well, the big winners in election 2001 in Scotland were definitely Labour and the Liberal Democrats, and the big losers, the Conservatives and the SNP. Labour and the Liberal Democrats, well, they held what they had going into the election. The SNP lost one seat and the Conservatives gained that seat. The last declaration was a couple of hours ago. That was at Argyll and Bute. It was a target seat for the SNP, one they really thought they could win, and they ended up, they came fourth, and it underlined just what a miserable election the Nationalists had. And although the Conservatives gained that seat, nevertheless, they're still a long, long way behind, and they've been relegated to fourth in Scotland.
Bernard, I was up in your patch talking to John Swinney a couple of days before the election. I got the impression from him that he was wanting all of us to believe that his focus was really on the next Scottish elections, and that this was a sort of almost sort of fringe event. Is he in trouble, though, as a result of this?
I don't think that he's in trouble, but nevertheless it is a setback in the short term. The fact is that the polls in Scotland show that the SNP will always do better in elections to the Scottish Parliament than elections to Westminster. This is the worst SNP performance at a Westminster election since 1987. The polls frankly got it wrong in Scotland. They predicted that the Nationalists were going to get 25, but as they head towards the Scottish parliamentary elections in 2003, they will probably find that their percentage share of the vote will be nearer the 29% that they got at the last Scottish parliamentary elections 2 years ago. Short-term problems, but not, I think, in the long term.
Bernard, nice to talk to you all through the night. Thank you very much indeed. John, just pick up on what Tony Benn was saying. I said he never gives up. He says the pendulum swings back. What's your own feeling about that?
I think that you would expect Tony to say that. He's a great figure in British politics, and who would I be to disagree with someone like him? But on the other hand, I think it's different. I think Tony Blair has a very clear picture of what he wants. He does not like that old Labour stuff. He's not sentimental about it. He didn't like the narrow kind of left sectarianism that operated in the Labour Party when he first came in. I think what he wants to do is to straddle his kind of Blairism across British politics. And I think he's now in a position where he can do that. He doesn't have to kowtow to the left. He doesn't have to pretend he's Margaret Thatcher. He can do what he wants to do. And I think that's quite distinctive. And it is what we come to call Blairism.
And the left, and there are some left-wingers in the House this time round, and that some of the leading members say, oh, we're going to be a real force. It's quite difficult to see how real a force they can be. This dog is not going to have its tail wagged by the left.
It's very difficult. I was talking to a cabinet minister the other day, and he said, we're in a different position because we're now in the centre ground. We must have centre ground policies.
Great. Thank you very much. And we're going to, as we've done before, in a minute, let you hear everything that's been happening in your own area, because the latest of all election news comes to you from the ITV newsrooms around the country. So go there, you'll join us later. We'll see you in a few minutes.
Hello, good afternoon. I'm Anna Maria Ash. This is London Today. Essex man and woman have hit back for the Conservatives, winning them three surprise seats. It may have bucked the national trend of a Labour landslide, but overall it was still a disastrous night for the Tories. As well as coming to terms with defeat, they now have to decide who should lead their party. Our political correspondent Simon Harris reports.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Essex man at home in the marketplace at Romford. But this is a rare breed of the species, a newly elected Tory MP bound for Westminster. In a truly terrible night for the Tories, Andrew Rossendale's victory in a Labour marginal offered a brief moment of hope for the party. it wasn't to last.
The Tory party will continue and will grow. William Hague has built very strong foundations for the future. There are a number of new young MPs like myself coming in, and we aren't going to give up on the Conservative Party. We're going to fight and fight, and in the end, we will be back in government, because fundamentally, the British people are a Conservative nation.
Not according to the rest of the country. Although in neighbouring Upminster, Angela Watkinson suggested the Tory revival in Essex might not be a fluke. And there was another rare Labour marginal to fall at Castle Point, the constituency covering Canvey Island.
The success in the three Essex seats is meagre compensation for the Tories. It's in London that the party is in real trouble. If the Conservatives are unpopular in the rest of the country, they appear doubly so here in the capital.
And I hereby announce that Stephen Twigg is duly elected as MP for Enfield Southport.
The man of the moment at the last election came back to haunt the Conservatives. Stephen Twigg not only held on to Enfield Southgate, he increased his majority.
I personally believe that as a party we simply were an unattractive proposition to too many people. We were an angry party rather than a warm and approachable party. We were exclusive rather than inclusive.
My friends, make no mistake, the Conservative Party will be back.
I'm sure William Hague, whose count will be later this evening, would want me to say that we appreciate all those people who have been candidates and who have worked for the Conservative Party.
In Kensington and Chelsea, Michael Portillo appeared to stand in for his leader. The question now is, could this become a permanent arrangement? At Westminster, this is Simon Harris for London Today.
So here's how the new political map looks in London. Labour lost two seats and now have 55. Both seats, Romford and Upminster, went to the Conservatives, and they're now up to 13, and the Liberal Democrats remain unchanged on six seats. And here's how it looks in the rest of the South East. Outside London, Labour lost one seat and now have 15. The Tories have gained one and lost one, so remain on 32 seats. And the Liberal Democrats have gained one seat there first here. And that surprise Lib Dem success was in Guildford in Surrey. Sue Doughty took the seat off the Tories with a majority of just over 500 votes, a result which went to three counts. And the drama didn't end there. Edward Davey held Kingston and Surbiton for the Lib Dems. His majority soared from just 56 votes to more than 15,500. Labour, of course, dominate the capital once again. Among the victories, Harriet Harman held Camberwell and Peckham with a majority of just over 14,000, almost 2,000 down on 1997. Tessa Jowell retained control of Dulwich and West Norwood with a 12,000 majority, down 4,000 on the last election. And Labour's Stephen Timms held on comfortably in East Ham with a majority of 21,000 in the first London seat to declare. That's nearly 2,000 votes up on his victory there in 1997. There have also been local elections in 11 constituencies. Three results are in. Labour have held Reading unitary authority with no overall change for any party. Labour have also held Thurrock, gaining one seat off the Tories. And the Conservatives have held Bedfordshire County Council. And we will, of course, bring you the other results when we get them. And that's it for now, but make sure you join us for a packed edition of London Tonight at 6, a full roundup of the election news and the rest of the day's news and sport. Back to ITN now.
Carlton Weather, sponsored by Amarada.co.uk, suppliers of gas and electricity.
Hello, good afternoon. Tonight those showers tend to fizzle out. We'll even enjoy some evening sunshine. Plenty of clear slots later on. Temperatures down to a minimum of 5 degrees, so pretty chilly night in the offing. Into tomorrow morning on a bright note to begin with, just like today. That doesn't last. We've cloud pushing down from the north, and by afternoon that cloud will bring rain with it virtually right across the region. 18 to 64 in Fahrenheit, but feeling pretty miserable with all this weather action, and the wind swings to become southwesterly. That's all from me. I'll leave you with our weather summary.
Carlton Weather, sponsored by Amarada.co.uk.
Welcome back to Election 2001. The national headlines now. Tony Blair has said that his victory was an instruction from the country to deliver. And the intrigue over who will be the Tories' next leader has begun after William Hague said that he intends to stand down. Well, one place the results are still coming in is in Northern Ireland, where the Ulster Unionist leader David Trimble is facing a serious challenge. John Draper there has been following the event. John, is it really possible that the DUP might oust Mr. Trimble?
It is possible, but I still think it's a wee bit too early to say. The Ulster Unionists are sounding a bit more chipper this morning. There's been a very high turnout right across Northern Ireland, and obviously all the political parties are saying that that's going to benefit them. But the Ulster Unionists are now saying that they think that talk a few weeks ago of a meltdown of their vote was premature, to say the least, and they're sounding much more confident. There's no question of the main political leaders here. Ian Paisley is going to be back, Gerry Adams is going to be back, John Hume is going to be back, but there still remains a question mark over David Trimble, but the Ulster Unionists say they're still confident.
I'm right, aren't I, that the principal issue in the election there is not some of the things that have been on the mainland, but is the peace arrangements, the Good Friday Agreement, and whether or not David Trimble will or won't be forced into a position having to say, yes, I will stop the executive in its tracks on July 1st.
That's right. It is the Good Friday Agreement. On the unionist side, the anti-Good Friday Agreement candidates have tried to make this into a kind of referendum. What they've said is there are lots of things they're very unhappy about. Decommissioning, reform of the police, the prisoners getting out, Martin McGuinness, an ex-IRA man, now being the Minister for Education here in the devolved government. What they're saying is give a strong mandate to Ian Paisley's party, the other anti-agreement parties, and they'll go back and renegotiate those aspects of the Good Friday Agreement that they feel so strongly about. Now, clearly, David Trimble is committed to the existing Good Friday Agreement. He says it's the only show in town, and on the unionist side, that's what the argument is about. How much support is there in the unionist community for the Good Friday Agreement that they voted on 3 years ago? On the nationalist side, both parties, the main nationalist party, the SDLP, and the Sinn Féin, they're both in favour of the Good Friday Agreement as it is. So both sides have been getting their voters out, both the nationalist and the unionist communities. But the real argument about the future of the agreement is on the unionist side.
Thank you very much indeed for that. And we will follow it closely. Bigger turnout there than here. One of the striking things about the last 24 hours is how much we've seen Tony Blair accompanied by his family. He's clearly been quite keen to keep close by them. We'll no doubt be seeing some pictures of them together in tomorrow's papers. In fact, that's a racing certainty. Well, Bill Neely has spent so much time with Mr. Blair recently, he could almost be family as well. He travelled with the Prime Minister from his constituency last night.
He was home and dry by the time he reached the embrace of the Trimden Labour Club, but above all, he was home. Once he'd come here as an unknown looking for a seat to win, now he was here as a re-elected Prime Minister. As he met his father, it was clear he was moved. His father had been a Conservative. He has now crushed the Conservatives twice, and a third generation of Blair's son and daughter were there to witness history. But today's history carries a burden.
The bigger the majority, the bigger the responsibility on us to do the job well.
On to London and on board his plane, time for champagne and tea, but no sympathy for the Tories. While he was in the air, Labour won dozens more seats. It was dawn. He'd campaigned across 10,000 miles in dozens of speeches and rallies, but never did the result seem in doubt. He may have made history, but it was he who carried his baby son Leo down the steps. He may be Britain's leader, but his car was still stopped by traffic lights. A lone car, no outriders, along the Thames to Labour headquarters, where the strategists and the war room staff were waiting.
For 100 years, we've been in government for short periods of time, but never won a full successive second term of office. Now we have.
And by a second massive landslide.
Well done, all of you.
But now, he told them, let's get on with it. 4 years ago, he walked through ecstatic flag-waving crowds to the door of number 10. This time, no crowds. There was a reshuffle to announce, new faces in a new government with a new mandate and an expectant electorate watching. Bill Neely, ITN for election 2001.
Bill Neely finally away from the family, at least for the time being. Interesting that, John, because quite different from 97. How does it feel to you?
Well, he's of course proved once again what a master he is of the public mood. He knows perfectly well how bitterly disappointed many people have been in the first 4 years of the Labour government. He wants to respond to that mood, as he has done during the campaign, saying, I know there's a lot more to do. So even at this point, He's thinking about public opinion. In that sense, it is like an American presidential election, which starts the day after the new president has been elected.
And it is not going to be as easy as last time either, is it?
He knows just how difficult it is. It takes 7 years to train a doctor. He knows all those figures. He knows how difficult it's going to be and how high the expectations are this time.
Thanks, John. We're going to take a break now. We'll be back very soon when we'll be catching up with Katie Durham, who was gauging the mood last night as she travelled the length of Britain. That's after the break.
I'll have him all alight.
Deliciously tasty and virtually fat-free. Muller Light.
There's Mile High Love and there's Muller Love. Oh, no.
What?
Straighten the machine, please.
Cheryl's seen it all before.
When you've a load too dirty for the laundry basket, all you need is one new Ariel Liquitab. Packed with concentrated cleaning, Ariel Liquitabs dissolve completely and clean brilliantly.
What setting?
Small load, shouldn't you? New Ariel Liquitabs. That's another load off your mind.
Now, this is Etruscan. Can you believe this is more than 2,500 years old? I think that is amazing. I mean, look at the symmetry of the form.
Oh, what a great bowl for salad. Some frisée, some rocket, some lovely cherry tomatoes, a drizzle of Hellman's dressing.
People who like food love Hellman's dressings.
From Burger King comes the famous flame grill taste of chicken. The new chicken flamer. The wholesome taste of flame grilled chicken topped with crisp, fresh salad. Burger King. It's all about the taste.
Welcome back to Election 2001. Two more leading Conservatives have had their say on the Conservatives' disaster in the election. One of them on the left of the party, Stephen Dorrell, who says he's not going to run, but says the electorate wanted us to hear us talking about schools, hospitals and public services. And the other, John Redwood, who ran and failed to beat John Major, is refusing to rule himself out this time, cryptically saying only, I think it's far too early for people to throw their hats in the ring. If you watched the programme during the night, you might remember we had regular updates from Katie Durham. Her challenge was to make it from Edinburgh to London with various stops along the way and to find out what the mood was like in the country. Here's her report.
Election night. My mission, get a sense of the atmosphere up and down the country and visit as many counts as possible between the polls closing and dawn. It would take four cars, two jets and a helicopter, and not all of those were planned. 10:15, Edinburgh's Meadowbank Sports Centre, and as the ballot boxes arrived at the count, it was time for the first update of the night, to set the scene for the political battles which would be won and lost in Scottish capital. Next stop, Manchester, but not quite as soon as we'd hoped. Our jet standing by had developed a fault. A replacement plane arrived, but more than an hour late, seriously jeopardising our already tight deadline.
We've had a bit of a hold-up. We're now on a different plane than the one we were going to get from Edinburgh down to Manchester. We're about an hour behind schedule, but we're hoping to catch that up during the night.
Manchester, a Labour stronghold and no election surprises. And at the GMEX Centre, our first hint that voter apathy had hit even the keenest of first-time voters.
It's a shame that less than 50% of the population actually turned out.
It's been quite poor, actually, on campus. And I think all over the country, I mean, just by the fact that so many voters haven't voted.
An hour south by helicopter, and it was a different story. Birmingham's International Convention Centre was the scene of Britain's biggest count. Again, few political surprises, but at least the spectacle impressed.
It was very exciting when all 11 were going on. I mean, democracy in action. I've had a lot of good arguments, and I've lost a lot of them too, which is excellent.
Finally, the dash back to London. We may not have beaten the sunrise, but back on schedule, we treated ourselves to a grandstand view of what the night had been all about. Katie Derham in Edinburgh, Manchester, Birmingham and London for ITV Election 2001.
Great journey too. Lauren Taylor is at Conservative headquarters now. Lauren, can you update us on the scene, the mood there?
Well, it's interesting. One of the people who's been in the building in Tory headquarters all day today is Michael Ancram, the party chairman. And he's been in and out a couple of times, but he's refused to say anything. But I do know that he's been having meetings all afternoon, presumably to cope with the fallout of Mr. Hague's decision to step down. But it's interesting also that although there has been criticism on the left of the party, as you were mentioning just a moment ago, about some of the campaign strategy, none of the possible contenders has actually openly come out and said they're going to stand. For instance, Anne Widdecombe, when she left here earlier, she was asked about her leadership ambitions, and she said something rather cryptic, all things decently and in order. And Francis Maude has also been saying that he wants the senior members of the party to show restraint, and he thinks that it's a period that people should use to take stock. So I think it's very interesting that that none of the possible leadership contenders has actually come out and said what they want to do. And at the moment, I think they're all observing a kind of unofficial period of mourning.
Lauren Taylor, thank you very much. All backing reluctantly into the limelight. We've been on air, we reckon, John and I, about 17 hours or so, give or take a little time off. How's the world changed, John?
It has changed dramatically. One of the strange effects, I suppose, of sitting in a studio like I do, trying to analyse what's happening, is you always worry about whether or not you've got it right. On this occasion, we started with a dramatic picture of another amazing landslide for Labour and deep trouble for the Conservatives. It didn't seem to show up in the early interviews. We persisted with that, and as the night went on, like bits in a jigsaw puzzle, it all fell into place. So for me personally, this has been an immensely satisfying 17 hours, though gruelling.
And an important night.
And very important, because no one can say at the end of all this, or if they do, they're being silly and haven't been concentrating, oh, it's all the same because Mr. Blair's got another big majority. It's quite different. We have tried to explain that.
And you're going to be closely engaged in watching the fallout from this non-stop now.
I'm afraid so. This is a message to my wife. It's not a question of come home, all is forgiven. I'm afraid a bit more to go.
And we'll all be watching. John, thanks very much. It's been good working with you. My final thought, well, they say politics, some people say politics is boring. Politics is boring. It's complicated. It's difficult. It's what people do when they make big decisions. And that is what has happened. We've had a landslide victory, a catastrophe for the Conservative Party. We've lost William Hague as leader of the party. There's going to be all kinds of warfare before they find a successor. Charles Kennedy has emerged as a significant figure. There was that low turnout. But boring, from here it wasn't, and I very much hope it wasn't for you either. From all of us who put this program together, a very good afternoon.
I wish I could have led you to victory, but now we must all work for our victories of the future.
Did I pass the audition?
You have given us tonight, an historic moment for the Labour Party.